This Equipment World video is brought to you by Chevron Delo 600 ADF Ultra Low Ash Diesel Engine Oil. It's time to kick some ash.
Hi everyone, welcome back to Equipment World. You're watching The Dirt. I'm your host Brian, and today we're here to talk about the other side of the right to repair conversation. As you may recall, here about a month ago, we had on someone to talk about right to repair from the side of people wanting to work on equipment in the aftermarket space. Today we're here for the other side of the conversation. How do manufacturers feel about right to repair, and what are their arguments against right to repair legislation? Here to talk about this topic with us today is Daniel Fisher with the Associated Equipment Distributors, and he's here to represent the other side of the conversation.
Dealers and manufacturers don't oppose the right to repair. In fact, we do a lot to support our customers' right to repair. You can walk into a dealership, buy parts, you have access to the service manuals, you have access to diagnostic tools, and a lot of our dealerships are now doing remote support to help the customer repair their own equipment. And I think what it comes down to really is, on as far as right to repair goes, is that if a tractor or machinery is out of service, that's bad business for everyone involved.
Sure.
And so I think particularly over the last few years, you've really seen dealers and OEMs get more involved to make sure that whether a customer wants to take their tractor to a third-party repair provider or wants to do it on their own, that they can do the vast, substantial majority of repairs on their own. And I think what we're talking about here is just a very, very few repairs that actually do require you to access embedded software and do those types of things. But as far as repairs, we fully support our customers' right to repair. And I think that differentiates us from a lot of the other industries that are on the right to repair, kind of battling this this legislation, these proposals across the state and now at a federal level.
And this is just speaking from my experience on the off-road equipment side. More and more of these machines, as they've become digital, computerized with computer chips, you're having to get into the software before you can perform some of the basic diagnostics to figure out what's going on. Are the dealerships opposed to third parties getting a hold of that software? What specifically are they really opposed to when it comes to the right to repair dialogue happening right now?
Well, I think we also need to look at what these bills and these proposals actually do. It's right to repair is kind of a catchy slogan, but it's really a lot more encompassing and a lot more complex than I think proponents of this will lead on. I'll give you an example. In many of these state proposals and the proposals that are actually in Congress right now, they would actually require dealers, or actually OEMs, to sell directly to consumers parts at cost.
Oh, wow.
Imagine, you know, the trouble there. I mean, it would essentially put dealers out of business, not to mention the logistical nightmare that would be if OEMs have to sell directly to consumers the parts. That might be the most troubling aspect of a lot of these particular proposals. I mean, a lot of the software that's embedded on these machines is there because of environmental regulations, safety regulations that come from the government. And so there's obviously liability issues when you start permitting unfettered access to the onboard computer system, whether it's a customer, you know, messing around with a machine and then turning it in as a trade-in, or, you know, these other issues. And I think it brings up a lot of different issues, environmental safety, liability issues, as well as the economic issues of forcing OEM to sell parts at cost that really, I think, would be personally just would totally disrupt the dealer network that's out there right now.
It does occur to me, too, while people are currently, the big thing in the industry is doing deletes on after treatment exhaust systems on these machines. And it does occur to me, it's not so much the ability to do those deletes, because it's currently being done. There's people who have found ways to hack the software and do that. It's more of the giving the open ability for people to do that without having to go about it unethically, if that makes sense. Instead of hacking into it, you're now turning over the keys to where it's just, yeah, go ahead and modify that stuff. And I could see where the argument against giving people the keys to be able to go and freely do that is. You're now almost condoning that sort of thing. Would you kind of agree with that?
Yeah, I think so. But also, I mean, the industry, and you probably recall this, I know you were in the industry for a while, you know, when we went to Tier 4 equipment, I mean, those were EPA mandates that OEMs meet a certain emission standard. And essentially what you're doing is you're basically saying, well, you can circumvent that, or, you know, there's safety mechanisms. OSHA has, you know, various regulations on, you know, in terms of safety. And you're basically saying, here's access to go ahead and do that. And so I think that's really the troubling part. And again, I think there's safety issues here when you allow this, not just as far as the dealership, but as well as on the operator side. And that's why you see, for example, the operating engineers in a lot of states opposing this, because they view this as a safety issue for their operators. So I think, it seems very simple on its face, but the legislative language is particularly much more complex than I think anyone... A lot of proponents lead on.
So my next question is, one of the big opposing arguments to the right to repair legislation is the protection of intellectual property. In your mind, can OEMs kind of build in these safeguards to protect their intellectual property while still allowing people to have access to the back end, you know, software and diagnostic tools that the dealerships currently have?
Yes, I don't know where the technology, that's kind of more of a tech question, I guess, and I'm not really... And also an IP question. But here's, just how, you know, we sort of feel about this. OEMs put in a lot of research and development time. And that's really what differentiates different OEMs from each other, right? So that's their intellectual property. And that's what makes, like, say, for Caterpillar different than Case or John Deere or any of these, is really the R&D that they put in and what they have in that intellectual property. And so I think it gets pretty troubling when you're kind of allowing then just everyone to have access to this IP. Now, is there maybe a solution that would, you know, as technology progresses that, you know, we can kind of figure this out a bit? I mean, certainly, I guess, possible. But I just know where it stands right now is that these companies put in a lot of effort and time and money into developing their proprietary software. And just to say, hey, everyone can now use that or have access to that software.
Yeah, they're not fine just handing over the keys to everybody.
Right, exactly. Not only that, I will say that it brings up, there's this economic argument, obviously, but there's also a security argument. I mean, look at the cybersecurity situations now. You know, you can have anyone hack in, essentially, once you start turning this stuff over. And also, it's a national security issue as well, when you're kind of giving up this IP to countries that we may be considering kind of our adversaries in a lot of ways. And, you know, so it's an international competitiveness and an international national security issue as well.
So my final question is, and you started to touch on it there in the beginning with your first answer, what will the big impact be to the dealerships if right to repair legislation goes forward in its current form?
But before we get into that, I want to take a second to tell you about the sponsor of this video, Chevron Lubricants. Protecting your diesel engine and its exhaust aftertreatment system has traditionally been seen as an either-or proposition when it comes to choosing the engine oil that's going to protect your system. And that's exactly why Chevron spent more than a decade of R&D work developing a no-compromise formulation. Now, I don't have to tell you why a clogged DPF is bad news, but here's the real kick in the pants. 90% of that ash clogging up your DPF and then upping your fuel and maintenance costs, it comes from your engine oil. You might be thinking, why don't they make an engine oil with less ash in it then? You'll be happy to learn that Chevron agrees with you. They've developed a new ultra-low ash diesel engine oil that is specifically designed to combat DPF ash clogging. Dello 600 ADF with OmniMax technology cuts sulfate ash by 60%, radically reducing the rate of DPF clogging and extending the DPF service life by 2.5 times. Before, you had to choose between protecting your engine or your aftertreatment system. Now you don't. Dello 600 ADF with OmniMax technology. It's time to kick some ash.
What will the big impact be to the dealerships if right to repair legislation goes forward in its current form?
As far as the economics go, as these bills are written, they require OEMs to sell parts at cost directly to consumers. Now, parts profit is, in many dealerships, the only thing that kind of
keeps the dealership afloat, really.
Yeah, really. And so you get rid of that parts revenue, and I think you're putting a lot of small to medium-sized family-owned companies, which are the bulk of the equipment distribution network, out of business. It's just not a viable business at that point. A dealer won't stock parts. And I think it's not just on the dealers. This will completely disrupt, I believe, the whole construction industry in a lot of ways, as well as the ag industry. We have supply chain issues now. I think if you look to a situation where you have to have OEMs shipping parts directly to consumers all around the country or the world, I think you're really getting to a situation where, I know the proponents of right to repair say that they have their, you know, combine stuck in harvest, or you have a tractor stuck on a job site and they can't get dealers to service them. If you think that there's issues now, I mean, I think this is just really going to exasperate the situation. And again, in our industry, I really do believe this is a solution in search of a problem, because you have access to the parts, you have access to do the repairs, and again, it's just bad business for us to have idle equipment sitting there unrepaired if a consumer or a customer wants to take it to a third-party repair provider or do it themselves. We'll do everything we can to make sure that's a productive piece of equipment.
It does kind of sound like it's not, there's just this general opposition to the ability to repair your own equipment. It's more of the fact that, as often happens with legislation, when it gets cast in a broad net with these very general terms, all of a sudden you're talking about aspects of the industry that really shouldn't be impacted, but are going to be impacted in a very material way and start causing hiccups for a lot of other areas of the industry. Would you say that's kind of a good summary?
Yes, I mean, there's certainly unintended, I think maybe unintended, but I don't know how unintended they are because they keep popping up in every state. But again, Bryan, you know, I talked about this before, legislation's not always the answer to every issue. And again, for as far as the equipment industry goes, I really do believe that we provide the right to repair, and we're not against the right to repair, we're against the right to modify. And I really think this is a solution in search of a problem in many ways. Maybe our dealers need to do a better job communicating to their customers that they do have the right to repair, but that's a communications issue, that's not a policy issue.
Well, Daniel, thank you so much for the time. I appreciate it.
No, thank you for having me.
Well, thank you again to Daniel for taking time out of his day to come talk about this topic with us. As you can see, with most of these topics, these are complex issues with multiple viewpoints. So I hope this is giving you a little bit more perspective on a very complex issue. As always, thanks for watching, and we'll catch you on the next episode of The Dirt.